All right, good morning, Asbury. My name is Alec, and I'm excited to be here and worship with you all this morning. I love Asbury because no matter who you are, where you've come from, what you've done, or what you're going to do, all the people here will accept you and love you and open arms to you anytime you come by. If you're a first-time guest here with us this morning, we love the opportunity to connect with you. We have two ways that we can do that. Option one is in the seat back pocket in front of you. There is a connection card like this. Pull that out, fill it out, drop it in the offering plate during offertory. Or option two is you can pull out your cell phone and text the word welcome to 281-305-1069. After you send that text, you'll receive a follow-up message to fill out that same quick connection card just online. And don't worry, we won't sell your information to anybody or send you a spam text unless you really want us to. Also, guests, if you want to stop by our welcome desk on your way out of worship this morning, we'd love to give you a small gift as a way of saying thanks for being here. Once again, my name is Alec. If you need someone to talk to after worship, I am right back there in the media booth. Without further ado, let's get ready to worship.
Well, good morning and welcome to worship at Asbury United Methodist Church. We know that there's some folks at home that are gathering with us, as well as those of us that are gathered here in the sanctuary. And at this time, we have the joy to lift our voices in song and celebration together. So if you are here and you are willing to stand and sing with us, if you're at home, you can follow along as well. Let's lift our voices together this morning.
I just can't win the fight, I'm slowly drowning. Good morning, friends. We are doing the children's message a little bit different this morning. You can come on up, but I'm going to ask the 12 Bible Blast kids to come forward. We're going to recognize this morning. It was Iris Bordowski, Larissa Bush, Isabella Castillo, Ivic Flores, Alessandra Gonzalez, Kinsley Hoover, Logan Kirkpatrick, Braden Kirkpatrick, Max Landman, Jake Landman, Kennedy Rendon, and Asher Waller. Excuse me. Some of these kids attended the traditional service this morning, and half of them attend this service, so we're recognizing all of them. But we wanted to recognize these kids because they participated in a six-week Bible Blast class where they learned more about their Bibles, how to use their Bibles, how to interpret Scripture to their everyday lives. We had two students, actually, who were able to say the 66 books of the Bible, Braden Kirkpatrick and Jake Landman, and I can't even do that consistently. And then we had some other students who came really, really close to that, and they also beat the pants off their parents, two youth directors, and a couple of volunteer adults in a Bible trivia challenge last Wednesday. The score, just in case you're interested, was 20-13, resulting in Mark Elliott, one of our youth directors, being pied by all 12. It's in the bottom right, friends. If you want to see how invested Mark Elliott is in our youth here at Asbury, there you go. But anyway, I am just so super proud of these 12 kids for going along their discipleship pathway. They served on Ash Wednesday, as well as some of the friendships I've seen them make. And we just wanted to recognize them and worship and share this with our Asbury family. So they're receiving a certificate. Like I said, some of them were at the other service. Iris Bordowski, and when I call your name, if you guys could come stand up here. Larissa Bush. I know she's here. Ivic Flores. Hello. Yeah. Alessandro Gonzalez. Hang on 1 second. Kinsley Hoover. Come stand up here, friends. Come on, Ivic, stand up here. Logan Kirkpatrick. Braden Kirkpatrick. Kennedy Rendon. And Asher Waller. We're always at the end with our last names, aren't we, friend? So Pastor Lindsay's sermon today, it's on Luke 8, and she's going to talk a lot about hope. And my prayer and hope for all of you is that no matter what happens in your life, that you always go to and rely on Jesus and the Bible and all the stuff that you're learning, that you use your Bible as a map and a compass in your lives, and that if you enter a time in your life where hope feels kind of thin, that you hold on and you let God and His Word guide you, all the stuff that you've learned. And Pastor Lindsay will mention in her sermon later that our ability to hope and the one in whom we place our hope, it never changes. And when we talk with Jesus and keep God's Word in our heart, there's nothing that we can't do. So you guys that are standing here, can you come up and maybe lay a hand on one of these students? And we're going to pray over them, and we're going to ask the congregation to help us pray. You don't have to. Lilith, you want to come up? Oh, I'm sorry. Okay, would you join me in prayer, please? Dear God, what a joy it has been watching these students get excited about learning more about the Bible. We are grateful for all they have learned and the fellowship shared while growing along their discipleship pathway. And we pray that your Holy Spirit will continue to guide them in their lifelong study of your word. We ask that you give them strength and courage as they grow in their faith, and may your love and grace surround them always. In Jesus' name we pray, and together we all say, Amen. We are going to have a special WOW worship service today for kids ages 3 up through 5th grade. We're including everybody because it's a foot washing service that we're going to do to learn about Jesus' service. Good job, friends.
Well, great job, kids. We're so proud of y'all. And good morning. It's good to see you. I'm Lindsay. I'm the pastor here. I'm glad that we get to worship together today. Here at Asbury, we know that following Jesus means worshiping Christ, growing in Christ, serving Christ, and sharing Christ. It's great to see that growth happening. I encourage y'all to go ahead and stand for just a second and greet one another and the love and peace of Jesus this morning. morning, Val. Hey. Hey, good morning. We got to reschedule. Yeah, we'll do that. Good morning, John. Hey there, Larry. Good morning. Good morning, y'all. All right, wonderful. Let's get back to our seats. Now we have some friends worshiping online. Good morning to you. We're so happy to be able to worship with you wherever you are. A few folks that I want to ask you to be praying for this week. Kristen McKee has begun her radiation treatment, so please keep her in your prayers. Mike Abel is over at Baywood Shadows. And then Kathy Schnautz had surgery this week, and she is back home recovering, so keep her in your prayers. Also, Trish Kellmeyer, her father, who worshiped with us at the early service this morning, is having a heart surgery later this week. He's 90, and he is ready to get it good and over with, so y'all keep him in your prayers, too. Let's go ahead and bow our heads as we go to the Lord in prayer. God of the crossing of the Red Sea, God who provided for Ruth and Naomi, God of the Tree of Life, God of David when he faced Goliath, God of the calming of the storm, God of the miracles, God of Stephen and Paul and Peter and Philip. We come to you this morning, God, to remember that you are the God of possibility, that consistently, over time, so many times, both in the Bible but also hopefully in our own lives, it has felt like there was no way, and then somehow you did the impossible. For as Scripture says, nothing is impossible with you. And God, that doesn't mean that everything gets fixed and doesn't mean that everything that we want to happen happens, but it does mean that we always have reason to hope. For truly, there is nothing that exists that doesn't exist because you planted it there. Everything that is possible is only possible in you. And so, God, if we have gotten kind of to the end of our rope, if we're low on hope, recall to our attention today that you are the God of possibility. For anyone that we know who's going through a hard time, we ask that you reveal yourself to be that kind of God to them this week. Anything that is causing our minds to wander, worries that just keep crawling back, we are going to lift those to you silently now. And God, we thank you that you are so much bigger and more expansive and understanding and wise than we are. We thank you that we always have a reason to hope, even if we have to adjust it a little bit. We always have that possibility in you through faith and trust in Jesus Christ. And Jesus, we thank you that you've proven yourself come Easter morning to be able to conquer anything and everything. So we place ourselves there, God, outside of the like calcifications and narrowing that can happen of our hearts over time when thing after thing comes our way. You are stronger. We ask that you forgive us of our sins, everything we do that pulls ourselves away from you instead of closer. We thank you for washing us clean. We thank you that you are doing things in our lives we can't even anticipate yet. And we pray, Lord, that we don't step aside, but that we step in keeping with your path. You are good to us, and we trust you, and we love you. We ask that you bless the gifts that are about to be given, and we pray all these things in the name of our Savior, Jesus, the one who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Now is the time in our service where you have an opportunity to give a gift to the Lord. If you would like to do so, when the music begins, you can stay in a place. We have offering plates by the back doors here in the sanctuary. There's also lots of ways to give online, either through that text message number, or you can go to asbury.cc and click on Give Now. You might not have been here on Wednesday night to personally pie Mark in the face, but even if you weren't, every time that you give, you're a part of that ministry and all the other ones of what God's doing here through Asbury. Thank you.
There's beauty in my brokenness. I've got true love instead of pain. There's freedom though you captured me. And I've got joy instead of more.
Oh, you give me hope down deep.
God, the way that we wait on you matters. An impatient waiting, an anxious waiting, or while we're waiting, we can be raising hallelujahs all the way. And so today we pray that you would help build up our faith, build up our trust, build up our hope, so that we can wait on you, praising and confident and sure in the God in whom we place our trust. As we read scripture today, we pray that you would illumine the words, place them in our hearts. This time is yours, Lord, and not our own. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Then y'all take a seat. All right, how many of y'all remember the movie Rudy? It's been a while, okay? So if you don't remember it, no big deal. It's based on the true story of a kid named Rudy who had a dream to play football for Notre Dame. And there was only one problem. He did not happen to have the talent. Also, he was really small, and he wasn't big enough to compete at that level. He also didn't have the grades to get into Notre Dame to begin with. And then along the way, he finds out that, like, his entire life he's been dyslexic, and he didn't know it, and that was kind of, like, part of why it was hard to get good grades. Also, no one in his family had ever gone to college before, so it felt like an impossible goal. Yeah, and if he had even found a way to get into school and then, like, make it to walk on to the team and somehow improve his skills and all that stuff, he didn't have the money for tuition. So he did not have one problem. He had, like, a mountain of problems. There wasn't actually anything going right for Rudy except for this completely unreasonable, driving, never-give-up hope that maybe somehow he would find a way. So his hope motivates him to get accepted to a local junior college. He finds a tutor who he can't pay, but he does it in exchange for dating advice. And then he gets a job as a janitor for the Notre Dame football team there at the stadium. But he's homeless because he's spending all of his money on junior college tuition. So he's sleeping in the head janitor's office at night. This is a true story. He goes back home to visit his family. They're making fun of him. What are you thinking? This is never going to happen. After 2 years at the junior college, he has been rejected from Notre Dame 3 times. But finally, after all of this, he does get accepted into the school. And because they know him already as one of their janitors, he makes it onto the practice squad. Finally, a shot. And so for 2 years after that, he's basically a tackle dummy for the first string players. And as his final eligible season goes on, it becomes time for the coach to decide who gets to dress out and join the team on the sidelines of the game. And Rudy doesn't make the cut. He has gone through so much adversity, all the trying, all the hoping, all the sacrificing, and he finally breaks. After everything he's done, it turns out to not be good enough. So he gives up hope, and he decides he's going to quit. And that's the moment when his janitor boss finds him. Take a look.
Since when are you the quitting kind?
I don't know, I just don't see the point anymore.
So you didn't make the dress list. There are greater tragedies in the world.
I wanted to run out of that tunnel for my dad. To prove to everyone
that
I worked.
What?
That I was somebody.
You're 5 feet nothing. 100 and nothing. And you got hardly a And you hung in with the best college football team in the land for 2 years. And you're also going to walk out of here with a degree from the University of Notre Dame. In this lifetime, you don't have to prove nothing to nobody except yourself. And after what you've gone through, if you haven't done that by now, it ain't going to never happen.
I've seen too many games in the stadium.
But you said you never saw
them. I've never seen a game on the stands.
You were playing?
I rode the bench for 2 years. Thought I wasn't being played because of my color. I got filled up with a lot of attitude. So I quit. Still not a week goes by, I don't regret it. And I guarantee a week won't go by in your life, you won't regret walking out, letting them get the best of you. You hear me clear enough?
Okay, so he's giving up hope, and he gets a pep talk from his boss, who, it turns out, gave up hope himself and now super regrets it and is trying to tell him, don't quit, you know, keep it up, keep the hope going. If you've seen the movie, you know that after, does it count if I ruin it, if it's like a 40-year-old movie? Don't tell me you were going to watch it later today for the first time, okay? He hits rock bottom. He's given up hope. He remembers what his boss tells him. He decides to give it one more try. He dares to hope again. He stays with the team. He's still on the practice squad. But before the last game, every teammate comes to the coach's office and plays down their jersey and says, let him take my spot until the coach relents. And so now he gets to run out that tunnel and he's all in dressed out and it's the whole game and he's not playing. And then all of the stands start saying, Rudy, Rudy. And he finally gets to go in for a few minutes at the end of the game as a member of the Fighting Irish. He finally reaches his goal. Something you might not know is the impact that Rudy's hope had, not only on his fellow teammates or the school, but on his own family. In real life, 5 of his younger brothers went on to get a college degree because they had seen their older brother be able to do it before them. Hope has a multiplying effect. It helps not only the person who dares to hope, but it is also contagious, and it spreads to everybody who witnesses it. If you are wanting someone in your life to have a little extra hope, you can exercise it yourself. They'll see it in you. It's an inspirational movie. If you haven't seen it, I encourage you to check it out. Some of us, probably most of us, can relate. Like, there's a corner of our lives where not everything went to plan. It didn't go the way we wanted it to. All the ways we tried to make it work, and it just did not work. And maybe we haven't lost hope about life in general, but like perhaps for this one thing, on this one goal, we have given up hope completely. It's just gone. It's over. And the truth is, you might be right. It might be over. There are some cases where the thing you hope for can no longer happen. It's done. Sometimes, though, it just feels like it is, and it isn't. God, after all, can do abundantly far more than we can ask or imagine, as Ephesians says. Miracles are real. You may be right. You might not be. The thing might be truly off the table forever, and maybe it's not. But here's the thing I want you to hear today, because you are in Christ, even if that's true, you still have reason to hope. You always have reason to hope, even if the thing that you hope for has to change. And there's this one person in the Bible who is absolutely a hope junkie. She cannot quit hope. She's a model for the rest of us. In fact, she's even a model for one of the guys in the crowd there that day. And I want to kind of just like you follow her story and see what she has to teach us. And so go ahead and grab your Bible. We're going to be reading from Luke chapter 8. That's the third book of the New Testament, but it's still pretty far back in your Bible, about 3/4 of the way. Luke chapter 8, beginning in verse 40. Good. Use your device, Bible from home, whatever works. It says, when Jesus returned, the crowd welcomed him, for they had been waiting for him. A man named Jairus, who was a synagogue leader, came and fell at Jesus' feet. He fell at Jesus' feet. He pleaded with Jesus to come to his house because his only daughter, a 12-year-old, was dying. As Jesus moved forward, he faced smothering crowds. A woman was there who had been bleeding for 12 years. She had spent her entire livelihood on doctors, but no one could heal her. She came up behind him and touched the hem of his clothes, and at once her bleeding stopped. "Who touched me?" Jesus asked. When everybody denied it, Peter said, "Master, the crowds are surrounding you and pressing in on you." But Jesus said, "Someone touched me, and I know that power has gone out from me." When the woman saw that she couldn't escape notice, she came trembling, and she fell before Jesus in front of everyone. She explained why she had touched him and how she had been immediately healed. "Daughter, your what has healed you?" "Your faith has healed you," Jesus said. "Go in peace." While Jesus was still speaking, someone came from the synagogue leader's house saying to Jairus, "Your daughter has died. Don't bother the teacher any longer." When Jesus heard this, he responded, "Don't be afraid. Just keep trusting, and she will be healed." When he came to the house, he didn't allow anyone to enter with him except Peter, John, and James, and the child's father and mother, and they were all crying and mourning for her. But Jesus said, "Don't cry. She isn't dead. She's only sleeping." And they laughed at him because they knew that she was dead. Taking her hand, Jesus called out, "Child, get up." Her life returned. It's a resurrection story. And she got up at once. He directed them to give her something to eat. Her parents were beside themselves with joy. But he ordered them to tell no one what had happened. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Okay, we've got actually two stories in one here. And I don't like using the word story because it sounds like fiction. It's not. It's history. But still, in this story, we've got a man named Jairus, one of the leading people of influence in the entire community, a synagogue leader, and he is desperate, the way any parent is desperate when their kid is in danger. His only daughter, how old was she again? 12. Yeah, that's right. Thank you. She's on the verge of death, and he has one hope. Maybe this Jesus man, whoever everybody knows is, you know, kind of off his rocker. He's been known to do some healings, and it doesn't matter how crazy he is, if he can help his daughter, he's willing to lay himself at his feet and beg, like any good father would do. That's story number one. Here's story number two. There's a woman, unlike Jairus, we are never told her name, because why bother, right? There's a crowd all around Jesus. The scripture says it is a smothering crowd. It's an Astros game entrance gate crowd, okay? It is a Houston Rodeo Metro train ride level of crowd situation going on, okay? Elbows are sticking out all over the place. This is important. We're going to come back to that. Here's my point. Everyone is touching everybody, right? Her purse and that kid's stuffed animal, and it's all packed in like sardines. You could not keep track of who is touching who. And in the middle of that crowd, trying to be discreet and blend in so nobody notices her, is a woman. A woman who had been bleeding for how long? 12 years. Okay. Now, a couple of things. One, if she's bleeding, by law, she is not allowed to touch anybody. This comes from the Old Testament. It was a way of keeping diseases managed so you're not sharing germs, right? Because her uncleanliness will contaminate anyone she touches and spread to them and make them unclean too. They didn't know how diseases spread, so this was a law God gave them to keep them safe. They used it sometimes when they didn't need to, right? But still, that's what they understood at the time. What this also means is that she has not been touched, not a handshake, not a hug, in 12 years. I want you to think about the isolation of that, the loneliness that she has endured. It's not just the physical illness that she's dealing with here, right? Here's the third thing. Jairus' daughter is 12 years old. This woman has been bleeding for 12 years, as long as that little girl has been alive. For the length of an entire life, which appears now will be tragically cut short. And in the Bible, the number 12 symbolizes God's perfect governance, his authority. It means whole and complete. When God talks about the 12 tribes of Israel, that means all his people, right? The whole group. When Jesus calls the 12 apostles, it means he's got everybody he needs. Everybody is covered. And in a cruel irony, this thing that is supposed to symbolize wholeness and completeness turns into a nightmare for both of these two families. Her 12th year might end up being her last. And this woman, in her 12th year of a debilitating illness, an isolating illness, has now run through all her money. Anybody with medical debt can sympathize with that. She has literally tried everything, everything else. And she's at the end of her rope. Lucky 12 for everybody else is horrifying 12 for them. Have you ever felt like everybody else around you was able to celebrate and you just can't? That is a tough place to be in. And verse 43 tells us no one can heal her. No one can heal her. Anyone else would have given up. But she can't quit hope. And she's heard about Jesus. So she breaks all the rules, all the laws. She tries to be inconspicuous so that nobody notices her. And in a crowd where everyone is jostling up against everybody else, she reaches out her arm with hope. One last ditch. Hail Mary. Maybe, maybe, maybe this will finally be the thing that works. And she touches the hem of Jesus' clothes. It was actually his prayer shawl. And at once, a miracle happens. She's healed. By the way, it's because Jesus took the old paradigm from the Old Testament and flipped it upside down. Now, instead of uncleanliness spreading to everybody, salvation and wholeness spreads, okay? She didn't make Jesus unclean. He made her clean. You see how it's flipped over right there? That's just how Jesus does. You don't have to get yourself fixed before you get to him. So then Jesus asks, "Who touched me?" And Peter, of course, is Peter, right? Captain Obvious. He's like, Master, dude, everybody's bumping up against everybody. And friends, this is one of the truths from this passage. I love this passage, but this is one of the things I really don't want you to miss today. There is a difference between bumping up against Jesus in your daily life and stretching out your arm to him in faith. We go to worship, fist bump Jesus, woohoo, we see a nice sunset, we're like, oh, good job, Jesus. Prayer before you gobble up the food on your plate, Jesus nudge, boom, great. There's nothing wrong with all of that. It's good to be aware of Jesus in your day-to-day life and have those little nudges, but there is an order of magnitude difference between that and the faith and hope it takes to reach out your arm to Jesus and say, I need you. I am desperate. I have tried everything else, and my only hope is you. And I wonder today if you've ever done that. If you've ever stretched out your hand and said, I need you now, Jesus. It's just a different kind of thing. And we know it's a different kind of thing because it was different enough for Jesus to be able to tell the difference between that kind of touch and everybody else's. Everybody in the crowd witnesses what just happened. They all see the evidence of what hope can do, as Jesus says to this woman, what her faith can do. Quick note of biblical scholarship here. Every decision to place your hope in Jesus actually increases your faith. They build one another. That's how it works if you do a word study of those two terms in the Bible. If you find your faith lagging, you might try putting your hope in Jesus, because one increases the other, okay? But here's the thing. If this woman's hand had bumped Jesus, nothing would have happened. No change in her life. Just like the rest of the crowd. It is only because her hand reached out in faith and hope that anything happened at all. And Jairus sees it. Back to story number one. For our purposes today, I want you to notice a key difference between our nameless hope hero woman and Jairus. Her hope never dies. Fortunately, she's never put in that position. She's being pressed. She's being pushed. She's dejected. She's sad. She's on the verge of giving up hope, but her hope never dies. It's just gone from a wildfire to a spark. Jairus, on the other hand, all hope is dashed to pieces. His daughter dies. I mean, it's over, right? Because sometimes we hope, and we hope for that person's sickness to be cured, and it's not. And sometimes we hope and hope for that person to beat their addiction, and they can't. And sometimes we hope and we hope to save the marriage, and it cannot be saved. Sometimes hope dies. The worst happens, and it is not Jairus's fault. Please hear that. He's doing all the right things. He is seeking the Lord. Jairus is trusting the Lord. He's literally laid himself at Jesus' feet, Scripture says, and his daughter still doesn't make it. Sometimes you do everything right, and you are hoping and you are trusting the best you know how, and it still goes wrong. And then after, Jesus does the impossible, and he ends up raising that little girl to new life. Jairus loses all hope, and then Jesus says, don't be afraid, keep trusting, and that hope gets reclaimed, resurrected in him. Jairus looks over at that woman, and he sees what just happened with her, and he has no reason to hope anymore, but he dares to relight the match. And I want to tell you, this is a tricky story to tell as a preacher, because I don't want to give the impression that God fixes everything, because not everything gets fixed. Or that if you'll just hope and trust enough, the thing you want will happen, because it doesn't always go like that. God has power and authority and chooses when to intervene and other times when not, and I will never understand why. But if somebody you love dies, if the tragic thing happens, it's not because you didn't have as much hope or faith as Jairus. God doesn't kill and destroy like that. But the reason that this story is still powerful and worth the risk of telling it is because even after the worst has happened, Jesus enables Jairus to pick up hope and faith again. And God can do that in your life too. A good friend of mine was burdened by the struggles that she saw her dad having, and they were really two kinds. One, he had been diagnosed with a degenerative health issue that was never going to get better. And seeing him come to terms with that and gradually get weaker was weighing on her. It's hard to stand by and watch that. You might have had that experience yourself. The second struggle was that he was mad at God and mad at church. And there seemed to never be any resolution to that, no healing for him in that, so he had turned his back on all of it. Then one night, he seems kind of confused, and the next morning, he doesn't wake up. He was taken to the hospital, and her first hope that she expressed through faith in prayer was, Jesus, heal my dad. Of course that was her prayer, right? It would be all of our prayer. But over a couple of days, she had time to think, and she realized that her dad's quality of life wasn't great, and it was never going to get good. And she decided she had to let go of that hope. So she found a new hope, and her prayer became, God, just let him wake up. She wanted him to wake up for years, right? That was the hope. Suddenly, her dad woke up. God had adjusted her hope, and now she was more like the bleeding woman. The thing that she hoped for had actually happened. But it quickly became apparent that when he woke up, it was to say goodbye, which was not really what she had been hoping for. But when he woke up, he asked for forgiveness. He said that he loved and trusted Jesus. He said he had faith in God to take care of him, and then he passed away. And so she grieved. And she's still grieving. And her hope died because he died. But over time, she realized that God had birthed a new hope in her. Now she has peace because she has eternal hope for her father, which is a gift she'll have for the rest of her life. God reclaimed hope in her heart because her father is in heaven, but also a different kind of hope because now she gets to tell that as part of her father's story. She gets to tell her own children about this legacy of coming to the Lord that he left for them. And she has a strong hope that God will use that to encourage their new faith. Miracles absolutely happen, and we can boldly ask for them. And we have an expectant hope that if we reach out our hand and cast our cares on Jesus, that he will take our sorrows and trade them for joy, as the song goes. But even when the miracle doesn't come, even when just what we want to happen is not the thing that happens, when your hope dies, God can reclaim hope in your life by putting it in a new direction and giving you a new hope. And I'm not talking about Star Wars. Your hope might have to die, but it can be resurrected. That's what this whole thing is all about. The thing you hope for might have to shift, but your ability to hope, the one in whom you hope, that never falters, that never dies. This is a powerful lesson from Jesus' ministry. Our ultimate hope is in Jesus Christ, and that never changes. Jesus is always faithful to us. We know our hope is in him. And for those times in life when we are hoping for something specific and you're close to giving up hope, hold on until Jesus tells you otherwise. Stretch out that hand. Ask for his rescue, for his help. And if, like Jairus, you are forced to give it up, then grieve it, surrender it, and then ask God to help you resurrect your hope in a different direction. And that might take some time. It might take a lot of time. But you can ask God to help you find your way toward hoping again. I don't know which of today's two stories is closer to being your story. I don't know if you're more like the woman who is still clinging to hope, and you will continue to, a hope strong enough that it causes you to reach out your arm to the Lord and say, I need you now, and the thing you hope for happens, and you can celebrate and worship and praise God for it coming true in your life. Or if you're more like in Jairus's camp, and you're hoping, and you're trusting, and it just doesn't happen, and hope is lost, you can dare to hope again. You can find the courage to ask God to reclaim hope in your life. He is absolutely able, and he will. Let's pray together. God, if what we've been doing lately is bumping up against you, thank you for not being too far away from us that we can do that. But also, God, help us to dare to reach out our hand like the woman and say, God, I need you. You are all I've got. You are my hope. If we've never done that before, help us to do that right now. We place all of our trust in you, all of our hope in you. You are our Savior. You are our rescuer. And we will hold on with hope. And God, if we have been in a situation where it's just over and done, help us to process that and to grieve it and to actually come to terms with it. But then, be the resurrection God that you have always been, and resurrect hope within us. And maybe the thing has to shift. And maybe the new prayer, the new hope is just, well, God, do something good. Do something. And that's enough. And if we don't know where to place our hope, help us to find a promise in Scripture and to cling to that with hope and say, God, you said you would do this. Wherever we find ourselves today, remind us that it's never good and gone. It is never over completely. Things happen that are not within your will, but your ultimate will always prevails. It has, and it will forever. And so you can reclaim that hope in our lives, and we're asking you today to come into our hearts and to take up that room again. So kick the fear out, kick the despair out. Help us to not pay too much attention, give too much weight and power to our circumstances, but instead to remember that you are the God who is capable of everything, and our hope will never be shaken. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
At this time, we have the chance to stand once again and sing together. This is a song called Living Hope. Just a reminder that the Spirit of Jesus lives within us, and we have access to that hope anytime. Let's sing together.
How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. And through the darkness your loving kindness tore through the shadows.
Thanks so much for being here today. I know that there's a lot of things that we can be doing on the weekend, and so to take time to worship God is super important, and I just thank you for doing that here. Want to let you know about a couple things coming up. This Saturday is our annual spring cleaning day. It's everyone's favorite. It's the most fun thing ever, but it is important, and the more folks we have to help us, the more we'll be able to take good care of this place that God has given us. If you look at the missions desk on your way out the door, you'll see signups, and you can even sign up for the, like, oh, I don't want to do that, but I'm willing to do this. Okay, we'll put your name there, and that's what you'll get to do. We'd love to have your help. Also, next Sunday, our youth group won't be meeting in the youth room. They'll be at Holly Bay Court Park, and they want to make sure you know that so you don't drive to the wrong place. They would love to have you for the picnic day they're going to have out there next Sunday at 4 o'clock. Also, next Sunday, right after this service, there's going to be a Vacation Bible School brainstorming meeting. If you'd like to come and talk about what can be for this summer with our kids' ministry, they would love to have you. A little lunch will be provided as well. In This Together is a group that we've got for moms who are parenting alone, and they meet today at 2. They would love to have you. They'll be in the WOW worship room, and there is childcare available for that. Blessings and blankets and blessings, whatever it is, it meets today as well at 2:30. And that's a group where you can learn how to crochet or knit, and they make blankets for folks and give them to people who are in hospice care. Make sure they know they're not forgotten. If you stop by the table in the main hall, you'll see that we are selling flowers for Easter. We use those on Easter morning here, and then you get to take them home with you. There's a couple options this year. And if you'd like to purchase one in honor or memory of someone, you can do that right out in the main hall. I think it'll be in the weekly email as well. I don't want to forget that today is Mary Peterson's birthday, and we all want to wish her happy birthday today. Make sure you don't fail to do that as you walk out the door. We have prayer partners, and they will be here as service closes, and they're just here if you'd like to have someone pray for you. I hope that you have a wonderful week ahead of you, but also, if you get to the place where your hope is just running on empty, remember, God goes before you to show you the way, behind you to keep you moving, above you to watch over you, beside you to befriend you, and within you always to give you peace. Amen.